Hello, this presentation was created by Georgia Meyer. I am a third year in the drawing and painting focus area, and I hope you enjoy my capstone. John Davis once said in his publication, Travels of 4.5 Years in the United States of America, that when enslaved women traveled to meet their neighbors, the girls never failed to put on their garments of gladness. Throughout the ages, the oppressed, overlooked, and rebellious chose to express themselves through what they wore. In the 1920s, women rebelled against patriarchal standards through promiscuous fashion and hairstyles. Then, in the 60s, Black Americans rebelled against racist hair standards by wearing their hair in its natural state. Even in 2020, a handful of men chose to rebel against the patriarchy by dressing in clothes many perceive to be feminine. Yet the most drastic fashion-armed rebellion is the least known. Let's rewind a couple of hundred years ago, when West African peoples were enslaved. The enslaved were stripped of their clothes before they even left the shores of Africa, and once sold, were likely given only 7 yards of drab fabric to create the clothes they would wear year-round. I'd like to think that their quote-unquote crazy quilt fashion began as a way to patch holes in their clothes or even add length to a short garment. Either way, the enslaved began to be known for their bold, colorful, and unique crazy quilt garments. To make these and other fancy clothing pieces, the enslaved kept chickens, made gardens, and exchanged cotton to purchase fabric. It is even believed that clothing and fabric were used as incentives by the enslavers to encourage better work. My painting depicts a trope of enslaved Americans preparing for a quote-unquote slave gathering. Slaves used clothing as a weapon to offend and defy their enslavers. To them, fashion was a small but valuable sliver of freedom. In order to help display said freedom, I decided to paint my figures in bright colors and used harsh textures on the wall, the outlines of the figures, and even the fabric. The figure to the far left wears a blue gown complete with a patchwork torso, a yellow and gold back, and a lime green collar. Sitting upon her grayscale head is a head wrap, a tradition carried from Africa. In the doorway of the gray textured wall sits a man painted in oil paint and resting. The man is wearing an indigo shirt and purple pants. Below the wall, two women sew. Both women are sewing crazy quilts. One, an elderly woman, framed by a ray of light. And the second, a child, wearing a dress patched with a floral fabric. In an attempt to add more texture to the figures, I decided to reuse an old puffy paint tube. I filled the tube with my desired color and applied the paint like I would regular puffy paint. To the right of the figures is a barrel used for dyeing fabric. Glued to the barrel's perimeter are scraps of faux fur. Finally, to the bottom right lie a guitar held by a figure who is not in frame and a chicken. Like mentioned previously, chickens were occasionally raised by slaves and traded for fabric or other goods. And in a way, this chicken also represents freedom. Throughout the history of American slavery, music was always sacred. It allowed the enslaved to entertain, work, pray, and mourn. Clothes not only gave enslaved peoples something to look forward to, but also an enhanced sense of community. Women, like the one in my painting, worked together to create beautiful pieces of clothing. And families worked together to save up to buy extra fabric. Slaves created, even in the most grim of circumstances. They persevered, even when freedom seemed out of grasp. Nevertheless, those who built the foundations of this nation found peace in their community gatherings and through their garments of gladness. In front of you is a screenshot of my original sketch for my capstone. And although I followed my rough draft to a T, there are still some things I would change. If I could do it over, I would add more quilts to my design. It is by far my favorite part of the design, and I just love making quilts. In addition, I wish I would have made my composition more busy by adding more chickens and maybe even another figure. And finally, I wish I would have incorporated more mixed media elements. Despite its faults, this is still one of my favorite pieces I've ever made. I've allowed myself to experiment in more ways than one throughout this piece. In just a handful of months, I've taught myself how to sew, learned how to properly use gold leaf, and learned I do not have to spend $5 on a tube of puffy paint. This project has also changed my perspective on historical art pieces. I've learned that not everything has to be 100% historically accurate to be a good art piece. Thank you for taking the time to listen to my presentation, and I hope you have a great day. Oh, yeah. Oh, I understand.